Hello and welcome to the online worship service of Altadena Baptist Church. I'm John Pomeroy and I'm the lay leader for today's service. And I really hope that we have a great worship service together. Please join me in prayer. God, here we are gathering for church in ways we never could have imagined. We agree now in prayer with hope that today's message is an inspiration to everybody watching and listening. We also ask that you bless our pastors and deacons for their faithful service to this body. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church, and welcome to remote worship again at Altadena Baptist Church. Now, you might think that I have it all together because I'm smiling and I'm standing here in front of you, but I make mistakes all the time. And one of the mistakes that I made was for this virtual worship team that you're going to see in just a few moments, I lost one of the pieces of video. And so I emailed Joel last night and I said, I'm sorry, I cannot find your video. I've got the audio, but I cannot find the video. And he emailed right back and said, no problem, who needs video? And just a few moments before that, my wife, Karen, had said, why do you even need video on these worship screens? Shouldn't people just be worshiping to the words? And I get that. We want to be part of a community right now. And so I do like putting people's faces on screen. But the two of them have a point, and God really struck me with this. And I'm going to read to you from Matthew 6, verse 5. It says, and whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees you in secret will reward you. And he goes on, and just a few verses later, he actually says, this is how you pray. And then he goes into the Lord's Prayer. So I took that as a word from both my wife and from Joel, that we need to really think of this time in worship as a time when we can really focus on God. We're not in a room with anybody else except for maybe some family members. So let's worship God right now. And so with this virtual worship team, let's worship together, fixing our eyes on Jesus. Let's sing the song Forever.
Sing praise, sing praise. is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever.
Well, it's good to be back with you again this week, and we trust the Lord has been in your home and in your life continually every day of the week. We want you to be as much part of the church as possible, so we are encouraging you to participate in prayer and Bible study groups, and you can find out specific information by calling the church or one of the pastors, and we'll help to engage you. Also, our phone tree continues to connect with people, and we hope that you have received a friendly call this week. It's our intention to be continually in touch with everybody. Our church is, we want people to know that we haven't gone to sleep because the corner looks kind of quiet. But we want people to know that we are still reaching out with the gospel. And so we've sent postcards this past week to every household in Altadena. That's some 4,000 to 5,000. And those postcards have a simple message. Basically, your local church is now your online church. And here's how you can access us. And also, we have some lawn signs available that go along with the same message. And if you want one of these, please contact the church and we'll see you get one. On Thursday evening, our deacon board will be meeting. And this is at 6 o'clock. And please, deacons, check for your Zoom connection. And then on Friday will be a youth game night. Our young people will be playing games on the long lawn, and they will be safe. They will all be masked and at distances. Otherwise, we'll arrest and detain them. No, we will enforce that because we want everyone to be well. It's going to be family feud. And Rob Ottaviano has prepared a great evening, and others that you need to be reacquainted with will be there. So show up, young people, 6:30 on Friday night. The church keeps going. If you have any special needs, please let us know. If you have any prayer requests as well. We love you, and we want to make this love overflow as the Lord takes us through this difficult time. God bless you.
Church, it's been wonderful to have Ty Garrison share his amazing photography with us and to revel in God's creation through that photography. But this morning we get a double blessing because Ty has kind of brought in both a global outreach focus plus his photography. So let's enjoy what Ty has to show us this morning.
Good morning, church. This is Ty, the nature guy here, and I'm here with my family from Brazil. This is my brother-in-law, Philip.
Hi.
This is my niece, Bella.
Hi.
This is Neji, who also works at Hope.
Hi.
And this is my sister, Corinne, who you've met before.
And I wanted to say thank you for the shoes that you've sent to our kids every year. They love them. You can see we're needing them again this year.
So, because they're here and in honor of them being here, I thought this week I'd share some nature pictures that I've taken in Brazil. And a couple of the boys from the ranch may have snuck into the photos as well.
Kathy came into my man cave a little while ago and suggested to me that the pain that I'm feeling from this toothache I've had for a couple of months might be exaggerated by all the trauma that we've been going through. Being the obtuse person that I am, I denied that we were going through any trauma. After all, we don't have any broken bones. Nobody in our family has had COVID-19. And we haven't been evacuated because of the fires in the mountains behind us. As if isolation because of COVID-19 isn't bad enough, we've now been trapped in our homes because of the bad air quality from the nearby fires. Now I feel quarantined, even though I routinely make Captain Hilt's style escapes from the house. How are you dealing with the trauma of the extreme changes in your lifestyle? Nearly every interaction outside of our immediate family is virtual, which isn't the same and nearly as satisfying as they were before COVID-19. And how does this affect us as a church? We're not communing like we used to. We may be singing along while we're watching church on YouTube, on a smart TV, on a computer, a cell phone, but maybe we're just listening now as other people do the singing. Are we looking at our phones while church is playing on a computer or smart TV instead of actually paying attention? Of course, that was a problem for some people even before COVID-19, but let's not talk about that. Apart from the people we live with, we're not shaking hands, hugging, or getting near people that we want to be near. And here's my confession. I miss hugging people and shaking hands. Sure, like I said, I've had a couple of Captain Hilt style escapes from the house, either to do something with or for other people or to work on the church kitchen remodeling project, all while maintaining safe physical distances. But it's not the same as it was. And what are you feeling at this time? Do you have somebody that you can speak with? And by that, I mean somebody you can really speak with, not just messaging on social media or text messaging on a phone. Is there a service you can perform for other people that puts you near them, but while maintaining a safe physical distance? How about a TLC group? How about the Thursday night prayer meetings? How about Zoom family dinners? I hope you have options. And if you don't, reach out to somebody you trust who might help you brainstorm some ideas to help overcome the isolation while staying safe. And with that, I wish you well. Now on to the last part of this message. ABC continues to need your tithes and offerings because all the ministries of the church are still going on. So let's pray for the offering. God, we ask you to watch over the health of everybody we know and love who are a part of this amazing church family. And we also ask you to watch over the health of this church by blessing it with continued financial support and the wisdom of its leadership to continue guiding us in our mission, our vision, and our purpose. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Give me joy that's unspeakable, and I like it, and I like it, yeah. Your love for me is irresistible, I can't fight it, I can't fight it, yeah. If life is water, I was dry as till some dirt. If it's a gamble, I've already lost my shit. If it's a journey, I was dazed without a clue. I'll flip to you back to the first love I ever knew. You give me joy that's unspeakable. I believe it, yeah. You
starts a battle, the invasion is complete. If it's a rhythm, I have found the perfect beat. If it's a renaissance, I've got a new birthday. The world don't give it and the world can't take it away. You give me joy that's unspeakable, and I like it.
Church, one of the ways in which I have been blessed over this weird time that we're in is by friends, relatives sending me scriptures, their favorite scripture verses that really encourage them. And then in turn, those scriptures encourage me. And so what I'd like you to do is consider taking your iPhone and filming, telling me your favorite scripture, and I'm going to share it with the rest of the church in the Sunday morning services. Here's one example.
I have three verses I'd like to share with you this morning that have given me a bunch of comfort this past week as reminders of God as a constant and everlasting Father. It has been so helpful for me to meditate on these verses because I personally have really felt like I'm living in such a hectic and chaotic world right now. With so much that's out of our control and so much that is constantly changing, it seems, on a day-to-day basis, it is so easy for me to just get carried away with the unknowns, which is why these three verses have been such a blessing for me to meditate on as reminders of God's everlasting presence, that He is a God who is never changing, and that has given me so much comfort. So the first verse I have for you is Isaiah 40:28. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary, and His understanding is unsearchable. Next I have for you Hebrews 13:8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. And finally, I have for you Malachi 3:6. For I, the Lord, do not change. So I hope that this brings you some sort of comfort, a small bit of comfort, as it did for me. I am praying for good health for all of you. Thank you so much. Blessings.
So don't think about yourself. And of course, the first thing you did was to think about yourself. That's the way we're built. In fact, we're that way for self-preservation. That is how our species survives. We have to think about ourselves first. It's in our nature. And it's not necessarily an evil thing unless we're preoccupied by it. It's just the way we experience the world, through these eyes, through these ears, through these life experiences, always thinking, how does it affect me? But if we're going to learn how to pray, we need to get out of that trap. We need to learn to go beyond ourselves. So I'd like to share a poem with you entitled Self-Love by Frederick W. Faber, a 19th century hymn writer. He wrote Faith of Our Fathers, which we are familiar with, and also There's a Wideness in God's Mercy Like the Wideness of the Sea. And Faber wrote a number of devotional poems that have meant a lot to me in my life. And I want to share this one with you, Self-Love. Oh, I could go through all life's troubles singing, turning earth's night to day, if self were not so fast around me, clinging to all I do or say. My very thoughts are selfish, always building mean castles in the air. I use my love of others for a gilding to make myself look fair. I fancy all the world engrossed with judging my merit or my blame. Its warmest praise seems an ungracious grudging of praise which I might claim. In youth or age, by city, wood, or mountain, self is forgotten never. Where'er we tread, it gushes like a fountain, and its waters flow forever. Alas, no speed in life can snatch us wholly out of self's hateful sight, and it keeps step whenever we travel slowly and sleeps with us at night. Oh, miserable omnipresence, stretching over time and space, how have I run from thee, yet found thee reaching the goal in every race? Inevitable self, vile imitation of universal light, within our hearts a dreadful usurpation of God's exclusive right. The opium bombs of grace may haply still thee, deep in my nature lying, for I may hardly hope, alas, to kill thee, save by the act of dying. O Lord, that I could waste my life for others, with no ends of my own, that I could pour myself into my brothers and live for them alone. Such was the life you lived, self-abjuring, your own pains never easing, our burdens bearing, our just doom enduring, a life without self-pleasing. As Paul said in Philippians, he emptied himself. Now, Lord, as we begin our prayer, help us for this moment to empty ourselves and to think of others, to think of those around us who are hurting, struggling with finances, with job loss, with disease, with just insecurity at this dark time, for those in our congregation who are going through struggles with illness. We lift up Liz Jones for continued recovery after her heart surgery, and Bill Sobris for relief from pain and for a continued recovery after the serious surgery he had this week, and for Christina Chavez's family and their continual recovery, for Gordy Horn and for others who are struggling and fighting against the weakness of the flesh. And now we pray also for our youth focus, a time when we think about the opportunities among us in our fellowship with the young people. We think of the Lumpkins today, of Eleanor and Charlotte and Hazel, three unique individual young ladies, each one with a potential unlike the others, each one with a unique way of manifesting you. Keep them and help them through these difficult times. We thank you for the quality parenting and homeschooling that Melody and Matt have been giving them, and we pray that they may just respond to be all that they can be for you. And in every corner of the world where we have global partners, we lift them up today. For Fred and Carol Lewis, who work to enable missionary candidates to prepare for fields that are unknown to them, to prepare with their language and their understanding of culture so that they can go in a positive way and minister from humility to people rather than from a sense of superiority. For the people in Lebanon who are known to us, for Sister Suzanne and her teaching work, as she asked our prayer support, for Jean and Patrick Bushable and Wham and their ministry to refugees in this difficult time. We pray also for the people in Brazil in Hope International. We've seen a little in our nature spot today about the life in Brazil, but there are not just animals there, but there are kids on the street who need love and shelter and a new direction. We pray that you'll bless Corinne Smith and Hope International and their work there. We pray for Altadena Baptist Church's outreach as well, as we've sent out 4,000 to 5,000 postcards this week to the homes in Altadena, recommending that their local church, ABC, become their online church. And we pray that you will cause people, just the right people, to respond to that. People who need hope in this dark time. People who are so worn out that they're thinking of giving up. And we pray, Lord, that you will help them to recognize the opportunity of fellowship with us and learning about you through this ministry. And now, Lord, we come to ourselves. We give ourselves permission to think of ourselves. And as a matter of fact, we are individually and as a group needy people, and we need to be filled by you. That is our greatest self-need, not to be filled with more self, but more of you. And we pray this with thanksgiving already in our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
We're going to start this morning with an exercise to check on your sense of time. I have a stopwatch here, and when I say go, you're to start counting the seconds. And I want you to raise your hand when 20 seconds are up. Ready, set, go. Time's up. Time's up. How'd you do? How was your sense of time? Were you too fast or too slow or right on time? We've played this game in the youth group, and no one raises their hands at the same time. We're all counting the same amount of seconds, but we all come to different conclusions. I chose 20 seconds for our interval because that's how long nowadays we're supposed to allow to wash our hands after we come inside from the COVID world. And I've often wondered if my sense of time as I count is anywhere near accurate. Sometimes I count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 because I'm just trying to get done with the chore. And then I have to count until about 100 to make sure I have enough time that way. And sometimes I find myself counting 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, just ridiculous things like that. I had a conversation with my daughter Lauren a while ago about whether or not time is actually, factually moving faster now. I see some of you nodding and some of you are rolling your eyes. Well, we all have our own sense of timing, which differs from the next person's. And sometimes those differences cause friction. We have all experienced anxiety, that feeling that we're too late. And we've all experienced the impatience of waiting on someone else. But what happens when our sense of time collides with God's sense of time? It's very different timing. When we feel we have hung in there more than is reasonable, more than we felt we were even capable of, and still we don't see God at work. When we have generously given God extra time to act, and still he doesn't. Pastor George and I just finished preaching a sermon series on Shaped in a Pressure Cooker, looking at the letters in the New Testament that were not written by the Apostle Paul, at a rate of one book per Sunday. Now that was a gallop. We couldn't linger because we had so much territory to cover. But one passage has stayed with me. So in this interim Sunday, before we start a new series, I wanted to come back and explore it some more. This is a passage in 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 11. But do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness? If you remember, these verses were written to answer a false teachers who were saying that the second coming of Jesus had not happened as expected within the lifetime of the original first believers after Jesus' death and resurrection. And therefore, there was never going to be a second coming. And Peter answers back by saying, oh yes, Jesus is coming, and he will be right on time. I feel like there should be an amen right about now. The context of God's timing in this passage has to do with the day of judgment in the end times. The West Coast has gotten a very heavy dose of fire, flames, and smoke in the past couple of weeks. So when Peter says that the day of the Lord is coming with the fire of judgment, we might just have a very current and visceral feel for that verse, given the images we've been seeing and the smoke we've been breathing. When he talks about God's timing, Peter is actually quoting Psalm 90, verses 1 through 4, and I wanted to read that now. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You turn us back to dust and say, turn back, you mortals, for 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, or like a watch in the night. So there it is again. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day, or even less. Sounds like a mathematical problem. If 1,000 human years equals one God day, then the 2,000 years that we have waited for Jesus to come is really only 2 days to God. Some people have actually tried to apply this literal equation to calculate some of the mysteries of the Bible. It's been done to predict the end of the world, to calculate the length of the messianic kingdom, to understand the days of creation, and to predict the day of judgment. 1,000 human years equals one divine day. Kind of reminds me of the way that we talk about dog years and human years. And using this verse as an equation does exactly the opposite of what Peter intends. which is to say that the gap between human time and divine time cannot be humanly calculated. That's his whole point. What the 1,000 years to one day ratio really emphasizes is that we cannot impose our timeline on God. This is no ends frustrating to us. If we just knew how long we have to hold on, how long until something changes, how long until God heals us, how long until God answers yes to our prayers, how long until we get a vaccine, how long until life is normal again, well, then we could gut it out. We could mark a calendar. We could count down the days or the months or the years. We could occupy ourselves with something else to pass the time before we get our reward. We can suffer as long as we know the suffering is limited. Have you ever prayed this prayer to the Lord? If only I knew when and how you're going to come through, I could wait. It's the not knowing that's so hard for me to bear. So that's the bad news about this passage. We will never be able to calculate God's timing. We will never fully understand his delay when it seems to us that he is ever so slow. Focusing on time is an exercise in frustration because our measurements don't work. So don't even go there. The image that came to me was of a rock climber on a particularly hard, smooth surface, looking, feeling for the slightest protrusion in an otherwise insurmountable wall of granite. There is so much about God that is unknowable to us humans, that we try to grasp, but we just can't. And I think of God's timing as an impenetrable mystery. His timing is that surface of granite that doesn't have any cracks or protrusions that we can grab. Think about it from a different perspective. God's great, glorious, magnificent plan of salvation is to restore his fallen, broken creation. His plan encompasses the whole entire universe. And here I am, one speck among billions, praying to him about his plan for me. In the grand scheme of the restoration of the universe, some of my prayers might seem minuscule. How does my life fit into the massive master plan? And yet Scripture assures me of my worth before God. It encourages me to pray. It assures me that God answers my prayer. When I ask for a quick fix, I'm only thinking about what I want. But in answering my prayer, God must take into account what is good for me. And that's different than what I want. God sees further than I can see. So sometimes I may be asking for the wrong thing, and an easy answer would undercut what is ultimately good for me. But that's not everything that's going on. God also fits my prayer into what is good for everyone and everything around me in ever-widening circles to include all of his creation. How God works everything together for good. Well, that also is the smooth, solid, impenetrable wall of awesome wisdom and power of God. And that, not even that is all that's going on. I'm also praying for bigger requests, for the global effects of the pandemic, for everyone who has lost property or lives in the fire. I'm praying for the Isan Buddhists in Southeast Asia, for indigenous peoples all around the world, for entrenched racism in this country, for the LGBTQ+ community. These are all prayers that I have prayed in this past week. And sometimes I pray those big prayers and I'm overwhelmed. I don't know what exactly to ask for. Sometimes all I can do is simply bring those people, groups, to the attention of God, bring them into his presence. And frankly, I can't grasp how God works for good on such a macro level, especially when what we see is disaster after disaster here on earth. And then to fit his answers into individual lives, but also into his master plan, which is both very, very particular, but also universal. How is God going to make things right? How is God going to save such awful, rotten, broken people who have messed up every aspect of his beautiful creation that we touch? In God's jaw-dropping plan of restoration, all I can see is the impenetrable knowledge and wisdom and power of God. And we will be amazed one day when we can see and understand more. If I can manage to remember God's big plan, my personal puny impatience with God's timing is tempered considerably. So on the question of timing, let's not even go there. That's the first takeaway, to let go of our own timing. Trust God's timing instead of our own. But if we can't figure out his timing, where do we focus? In that otherwise impenetrable surface, where's the next toehold? Where's the next finger hold? Both passages point to God's character as the places that we can hold on to that will move us forward to a better place. In Psalm 90, the emphasis is on God's eternity and power. God has sovereignty over all of the entire universe, including the passage and measure of time itself. As creator, God is outside of time. He was, he is, he will be. He is from everlasting to everlasting. Our human life is too brief to comprehend the scope and the purpose of God's plan. And this is comforting, because even though we may never understand his long game, still from generation to generation, God has been our dwelling place, the psalmist proclaims. We have a very long history of his unchangeable faithfulness and love, and that we can count on, that we can hold on to. God himself is our place of safety. He is our hiding place, even when, or most especially when, his timing confuses us. And 2 Peter points to another character trait, patience. Why is God's timing off according to our human timing? Because he is merciful. God's kindness is giving room for repentance. Not enough people have yet come to him for forgiveness and for a new, abundant life. Now, this is the opposite of what we see in the Old Testament. There, we hear calls for justice because there's just too much wrong in the world. You ever thought that? There's just so much wrong, we just want God to come and set things straight. Surely that much evil will motivate God to judgment, because all these people got to pay for the wrong they have done. So the Old Testament prayer warriors called upon God to show up so that evil could be stopped. And many of us have prayed or thought along those lines too. But in our 2 Peter passage, God withholds judgment because there is too much evil. How does that work? If he came now, too many people would perish, and that's not God's desire. God's mercy causes a hesitation in God's justice. So at the heart of God's timing, at the heart of God's patience, is people. And of all the people in the world, it's the very ones who try one's patience most sorely. You've met them. You know exactly who they are. They are the ones that make you count silently and go inward and try to get a grip on yourself, because if you open your mouth, it's going to all be over. The ones that make you narrow your eyes or roll your eyes or clench your fist or walk away. It doesn't make you lose your temper because they are so very, very trying and trifling and just plain wrong. Do you have someone in mind like that? At the heart of God's patience are all these terrible people, the worst people of all, maybe including you and me. God is not slow. He does not delay. He is patient so that we will all have enough time to turn to him. And we who live in the most impatient of cultures have the most patient and loving God who desires to show mercy. In the scenario where we are eager to zap the very people that God wishes to save, where does that put us? It really should trouble us if we're at cross purposes with God. Our impatience should trouble us. It should cut our heart to the quick to realize that the people we are ready to call down fire and brimstone upon are the very people God spreads his arms to, and he wants to envelop them in mercy and patience as he waits for them to turn to him. So when God is slow towards us, we need to know that his timing is fueled by mercy. He isn't slow in order to teach us a lesson. He isn't too busy or too bothered to care. He doesn't enjoy our suffering. No, his purpose for us is to rescue us, to save us, to show mercy to us. So trust God's mercy in his timing, even if we can't understand his timing. God's impenetrable timing is also connected to his love of process. Now, I don't know why God loves slow, cumbersome, messy, emotional process so much, but he really does. He does not want us to leapfrog the valleys and live permanently on the victorious mountaintops. He wants to walk through the valley of the shadow of death with us. He wants us to depend on him. And I don't know if you've ever had to depend on God, but depending is excruciating. But we lean more on God when we're in the lows, when we're forced into dependence more than we ever would in the highs. I think God is after one precious gift that we have to give him, which is our love and our trust. God wants faith from us. We don't get to spend eternity with him without faith. And mind you, our faith is kind of like the child who asks his mom for some money so that he can buy her a present. God gives us the faith that we then give back to him. But it's in our freely giving him our faith that it becomes a precious gift to him. Faith is different in different people or in different seasons. My faith is not going to look exactly like your faith. Sometimes faith is accompanied by strong feelings of love and trust, and it's just good to be a person of faith. But sometimes it's a truth we proclaim when the feelings are not there. And at times, we feel that our faith is stretched very, very thin. And then we get to choose whether to hang on in faith or to give up. And when we choose the former, our faith grows stronger. Paradoxically, at the time when we feel that it's at its weakest. And that faith in God, no matter what our external circumstances of our lives, becomes a precious gift that honors God. I guess the reason I wanted to talk about these passages is because of the strange times that we live in. We have been put in a timeout by God. normal living stopped as of mid-March, or it stuttered or it sputtered. The direction that before seemed so clear now got murky. The pathway from school to job or to career, from singleness to being in a relationship, like how do you even meet someone to date in this pandemic? From paycheck to paying all of the bills, that pathway has quieted and slowed and been disrupted. How long, O Lord? We are so ready to return to normal. Or maybe we have a long-term prayer that we have wrestled with for months, for years, that's not related to the pandemic. If we knew how long, we could wait better. We wonder what God is up to and why he's so slow. So in the strange seasons of life, when we must depend on God's timing, let's hold on to those toe holds and the finger holds that he has given us. Let us hold on to God. And we find as we quiet ourselves, as we place ourselves in God's hands for his timing, that we are able to give God the gift he's been after all along, the gift of trusting him, the gift of faith, the gift of trusting his God timing. And we find that for all our holding on, it's really God who is holding on to us. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear God, you know that we have questioned your timing for us many times. And still you hear us, and still you come to us, and still you care for us, and still you are active on your behalf. So we want to proclaim today the truth that you are a faithful God. You have always been faithful, and you will be faithful in the future, and you will be faithful in what we're going through right now. We proclaim this, Lord, as an eternal truth. And we proclaim your goodness, God, that even when things are so wrong and so turned upside down, that you are a God who intends good and who will bring good out of all circumstances, even when we can't see it right now. And we want to tell you that we love you, that we have faith on you. We even want to pray the great prayer in the Bible, I have faith, Lord. I have belief, help my unbelief. So help our unbelief, God. We want to tell you that we do believe. Thank you for being with us through all seasons of life. Thank you for your promises. And thank you for the process that gets us to those promises. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence. And it's in your name that I pray. Amen. And now for the benediction, may God hold you and keep you, not just now, but into the next season of life and into the next season until the glorious day when he takes us to our forever home. Amen.